He's in the starting lineup tonight, but we'll have to keep an eye on his health, how long he plays, and how hard he's able to go.
Yeah, we've got to see if this is a real flu or the Michael Jordan flu. But he looked good in warm-ups to me. But, again, that's where fatigue in the second half is going to come into play if he really does have the flu.
BYU in the white jerseys, Valpo in the gold jerseys. This is a rematch of the NIT semifinals from a season ago when Valpo took down BYU in a nail-biter. And Nick Emery trying to redeem his Cougars here tonight.
And that's a great sign for the Cougars. He's a guy that has not been shooting well thus far this season, and he's a guy that they've expected big things from. So getting that first shot's big for a score.
And he's a guy, too, as we talked to his teammates before this game, that decided on the trip here in between games yesterday, as Adekoya missing the straightaway field goal and an offensive rebound for Valpo. Nice put back by Tavon Walker. Nick Emery, who hasn't been shooting well, you mentioned, Steven, decided yesterday on the off day to go get a haircut, maybe change things up.
Yeah, very strange to me, but he's been shooting so poorly that I'm sure he just figured that I have to try something to kind of get my mojo working, and it looks like it's working thus far.
Back-to-back threes for the Cougars. This time it's TJ Hawes, the freshman.
But for Emery, though, this is that one time that what happened in Vegas is getting publicized across the nation.
I'm finicky about who cuts my hair. I don't know if I would trust somebody on the road.
Particularly when you're in Vegas. I mean, that's a lot of trust to just throw out there.
Double team down low, and Adekoya with the travel. Turnover on Valpo. And it's an interesting matchup, especially down low. And you mentioned BYU hasn't really been shooting the three well, and yet they come out and fire two right off the bat.
Yeah, and that's something that I'm sure Coach Rose wanted to get them going shooting. And this was a team last year that if they did not shoot well, they would lose. But because of the interior presence of Mika and Davis, it's turned into an interior team. And so they've carried them. So if they have that outside shooting, they're going to be a force.
Dave Rose coaching here since 2005. He's 11 straight seasons of 20-plus wins or more and has taken BYU to the NCAA tournament 8 times in those 11 seasons as well. We mentioned the semifinal appearance in the NIT last year, losing to this Valparaiso team who went on to lose in the championship to George Washington of that NIT tournament. And this is a team that feeds off of this man, Alec Peters, as they feed Peters down low and he can't find the bucket. Bodies hitting the deck. But Stephen, when you think about the history of Valpo and BYU, you don't think of big guys. You think of point guards like Bryce Drew, or you think of Jimmer Fredette. Matt Loddick is a point guard in his own right, coming out of Stanford, now a first-year head coach of Valpo. Yet they have seemed to find themselves in this system now where both teams are reliant on their big men.
Yeah, and this is a kind of a different type of a game, because there's not too many times in college basketball where you have two teams that play through their bigs. And so really this is going to be a battle in the block, and whoever wins that's going to come out on top.
Here's Emery trying for his second three-pointer of the game. Friendly roll off the backboard and the front of the rim and in.
And those are the type of shots that he takes, those shots that the coach is like, okay, yeah, great shot. And you live with him and you die with him. But when he's knocking him down like he is right now, he's tough to play against.
And Emery with the steal, and that is something that BYU fans are used to seeing, an Emery getting steals, as his brother Jackson is the all-time leader in BYU history for steals in a career, as you see the lucky roll there. And it's Las Vegas. You're going to get lucky sometimes.
Yeah, and those are shots that were not rolling for him. And so I think this team feeds off his energy, and the fact that he's knocking them down is really good for this BYU Cougar team.
Davis with the left hand. Might have been blocked partially by Tavon Walker, who now leads the break for Valpo.
And you look at the pace of this game. Valpo wants a half-court game. They don't want this game in the 70s. But BYU, they get it up and out. They shoot the ball under 13 seconds. That's second.
Jabril Adekoya, the senior out of Tinley Park, Illinois, with the easy lay-in.
And Jabril had an amazing game on Monday. Really was able to take advantage of mismatch against Alabama.
It is raining here in Las Vegas. Not necessarily outside, but here in the MGM Garden Arena.
When you look at the way the Cougars played last year, they made 9 threes per game. They're a little under 6 threes per game, so they like to get it up and out. This is a good sign for the Cougars.
BYU now 4 for 4 from long range, as Adekoya can't match on the other end. BYU came into this game averaging 29% from long distance, so obviously a much better start than their season average would have told you.
And Eric, that last shot by Jabril was an instance of him just taking it too early, getting caught up in the fast-paced tempo of BYU. And then once BYU gets it, their best offense is in transition. You see them getting it up and out. And they're taking advantage of numbers. And Valpo cannot afford to get into a running game with BYU.
BYU with a dozen, and because they've hit so many threes, we haven't got a chance to talk about the guy at the free throw line here. That's Eric Mika. As you see, Dave Rose, I mentioned those 11 straight 20-win seasons, was a three-time Mountain West Coach of the Year before BYU switched to the West Coast Conference, and he's got a stud, and Eric Mika.
Yeah, I mean, this guy, as a freshman, was all freshman, did everything, went on his mission, came back. He had five double-doubles as a freshman. Now he's got three in the first four games. So he is come back on fire, but he's the main guy for them, and he's the interior presence for the Cougars.
Served his Mormon mission in Italy, didn't touch a basketball in 2 years, comes back, and he's averaging 21-11. Nice drive, but the left-hand finish, Alec Peters was strong.
And see, that's where BYU is good also. They protect the rim well with Davis and Mika down the block.
Rue lets out for L.J. Rose. Devon Walker, hesitation. Walker trying to go coast to coast, and Valpo missing a couple gimmies at the bucket.
Yeah, and you got to look at the rim protection of Davis and Mika. They will get up and challenge every shot.
Loose ball foul called against BYU will go against Mika. The Cougars lighting it up from long range. They leave Valpo.
Oh, definitely in my mind. And you even see the schedule that they're playing. But you look at Valparaiso, and particularly with Alec Peters, the way that he's playing this year, their team that definitely is going to contend in the horizon. But BYU, with this youth and that new interior presence for them, I can't wait to watch them play Gonzaga down the road, because that's going to be a battle.
Absolutely. Adekoya just hasn't been able to find any love on the rims. He's now 2-for-5 from the floor. Mika's pass intercepted by Peters. So much for that flu. Hamming up with the left hand. Offensive rebound by Joseph, and a foul.
Foul called on the rebound.
Now, you notice a nice double team. Every time they come down, they practice this and shoot around and in practice. Peters going down in the double team, good hands, and then taking it in transition, leading the fast break. Valpo is a team that they don't, you're not looking to run, but if they have it in transition, they're going to take it. And that was a good example of just being very judicious in transition.
Now, Eric Mika has two fouls, so he has to go to the bench. Almost the exact same thing happened here on Monday night against St. Louis. He picked up his second foul 6 minutes into the game and then didn't play for the remainder of the first half.
Yeah, and that's maturity. That's one of the, you got to remember, he's a sophomore that hadn't played in 2 years, and so that's the growing pains that you're going to have to deal, the inexperience that this BYU team has.
So in his place is Yoli Childs. He feeds down low inside to Kyle Davis for the and one.
You're noticing every time down, Valpo knows that BYU is an interior team. When it gets on the block, they are double teaming immediately. BYU hasn't gotten good passes, but that moment, Yoli, nice pass down low to Davis. Davis goes up strong, plays through the contact. That's what they're going to have to do all night long, because it's going to be consistent double teaming.
Kyle Davis, this will be his only season with BYU. He kind of bounced around as a freshman with Southern Utah and then sophomore with Utah State, and he sat out a year, so now a senior, and the Cougars are hoping to get as much out of him as possible in this 1 year, as Hamming misses with the right. And Steven, the issue is not getting the ball inside for Valpo, it's finishing.
Yeah, and that's something really that's been a problem for them for distance and on the interior, and they've just struggled shooting the ball thus far this year. They're getting good looks, but it's just getting in there and knocking the shot down.
Foul on Nick Emery. Excuse me, on Yoli Childs, picking up his first foul of the game. And this is Shane Hammock, the senior from the Netherlands. His father, Gert, a former first-round draft pick, and played 3 years in the NBA, so a little bit of lineage. And Valpo, no stranger to some NBA fathers, as they have Rick Smith's son, Derek Smith, as a freshman off the bench.
Yeah, and Gert Hammond backed up the Big Diesel in LSU. That's not a
not bad
backup. And he backed him up in Orlando as well.
Almeida Arroyo out of Spain. A couple international players on the floor now for the Crusaders.
Valpo switched it up, got into his zone, and they did a good job of that on Monday, confusing Alabama throughout the night with that changing defense.
Surprised they're moving into the zone with how well BYU has shot the three early on here?
Not really, just because when you change up a zone, you're going to change up the look, and sometimes that's going to throw the rhythm off, and anything can get a shooter off, and you see they missed that first shot by T.J. Hogg.
Emery just needs a little bit of space before he fires. As after hitting his first two, he misses his third three-point attempt.
No, they're going to need to get Alec Peters going for Valparaiso. He's going to be the guy who's going to get them back into this game.
Amick charging in and got called for it. A foul on Shane Hammack. Mentioned Eric Mika playing his freshman year three seasons ago, and then going on his Mormon mission for 2 years, and now coming back and trying to get reacclimated. His stats are fantastic. He's just dealing with a little bit of disciplinary issues on the foul trouble.
Well, and that's what he's going to have to adjust with these new rules. He's a physical player. He loves contact, but he's going to have to know when he can and cannot play physical.
Nick Emery trying to volleyball that Elijah Bryant miss. 16-9, BYU.
Valpo needs to get a bucket, but they need to really get it to Peters and get him going.
Hammack double teamed on the baseline.
Credit the defense of the Cougars. They are keeping a man on Alec Peters at all times.
A foul underneath. And you mentioned those new rules, and that's one of them. And the new rules that are being emphasized this season are leaning on the interior player. If you're a defender, you can't lean on him. You got to give him his space.
Yeah, and you see Alec Peters is playing smart, and they favor the offensive player that can play down on the block. And you see, once you have that elbow on, and they're going to give you one bump, but you get that second bump, and the officials are instructed to make that call. So smart move by Peters.
So Childs picking up the foul. Now that's his second. So Mika and Childs, now two of the big guys for BYU, on the bench with two fouls. And now an offensive foul on Valpo. Alme Soroya, the freshman center, setting an illegal screen.
And really, that was just Jay Soroya just posting up big in the interior, what you teach him to do. Valpo still in that zone. That's really worked well for them since they instituted it.
BYU has slowed down after hitting 4 3-pointers to start this game. Since then, only 4 points as a turnover on the Cougars. This time, Elijah Bryant caught with the travel.
And Elijah Bryant's going to be big for BYU. He's battled some injuries. He hadn't totally got back. He was a Colonial Athletic Rookie of the Year. When he gets back, he's going to be that swing athletic player that can score, can defend. And he's going to be big for them once he gets his timing back.
Opportunity for Valpo here, as they have been unlucky from distance. Now 0-for-3 from long range, and just 3-of-11 from the floor for the Crusaders. Jamal Ates, the junior out of San Diego, fouled going up, and it's just a rotating door of big men for the Cougars.
It really is, and that's where they have that depth. You see, LJ Rose, he got the rebound on the other end, and he drew the defense to him and dimed it, and that's the experience that he's a calming influence on this team, but he's a pass first guy, and you see him setting the table for his players throughout this game.
6 fouls now as a team on Valpo. That's Jason Royo's second personal, and 8 at the free throw line. And Stephen, BYU hit their first 4 3-pointers. They missed their last 3, and they've gone 1-for-6 from the field in that time, yet Valpo hasn't been able to do anything about it.
Yeah, and that's what that 3 does. It's that great equalizer that allows you to distance yourself from other teams. And really, BYU has been riding that momentum from early on. And to me, it's the defense the Cougars have been playing on Peters, not allowing him to get off thus far in the game.
And at that point, we see Peters catching the ball in the left wing and committing the traveling violation.
Well, the officials are instructed, once you catch the ball and establish that pivot foot, they're going to look at that pivot foot. Peters just dragged it just a little bit, and that little bit is all they need to make that call. And that was a good call.
It's the 6th turnover of the game on Valpo. not helping their cause as they trail 18-9. Just under 12 minutes to play here in the first half. Eric Rothman, Stephen Howard with you from the MGM Grand Garden Arena in Las Vegas. Good head fake by Nick Emery, and that stops the BYU drive.
And Eric, that's one thing you can't do against the shooters of BYU. When you close out, you need to close out controlled. Saw Valpo out of control, went for the head fake, and Nick Emery just got him up in the air and knocked it down.
Emery now with 9 points, all of those coming from long distance. Quarter jumper by Derek Smith's not there, the freshman off the bench. Good block on the inside by Davis. Peters got it back, and one. And Eric Rothman, Stephen Howard here with you. That's Nick Emery. He's been leading the charge for BYU. Last year as a freshman, he tied a school record with 10 three-pointers made in a single game. He's got three here tonight already, Stephen, and that's much better than his 27% three-point average has been throughout the first four games of the year.
You're absolutely right. He's 11 percentage points lower from the three than he was last year, and with Mika on the bench and struggling thus far in this game, they need to have that three-point production by him. Really, he's right on time coming up with that confidence.
TJ Haas keeping the ball alive twice, once for an over and back violation, the other as it bounced off his knee, yet the Cougars lose it anyway.
Good job by Valprezo, active hands, once the ball got in the painted area, able to knock it off Elijah out of bounds.
Valpo with Max Joseph, the junior guard out of Montreal, now at the point guard position. Peters, shake and bake, up with the right hand, and finishes strong.
And that's exactly what Peters needs, a tough contested take into the painted area, but he went through that contact for a very contested two.
Elijah Bryant, the sophomore on the other end for BYU, a quick response.
You know, talking to Coach Lottich before the game, he talked about that NIT last year and the fact that BYU controlled the tempo in the first half like they are in this game, and Valprezo was able to control tempo in the second. But Valpo cannot run up and down with BYU, and that's what they're trying to do in this game.
And one opportunity for Shane Hammack getting inside, and a block called on Kyle Davis, and he can't believe it.
See, one thing you got to realize with Shane is he's a lefty, so he's going to get you up in the air and go to that sweet spot on his left, able to throw in the layup with his right. But the lefties are awkward to defend against, and you see him using that to his advantage on that attack into the painted area.
And the Boo Birds not only not happy with Kyle Davis's foul, but they're also not happy with the fact that Shane Hammack is at the line, because Shane, if you remember, in the semifinals of the NIT last year when these two teams met, BYU had a last second opportunity to win that game with a three, and Shane Hammack came in for the block to steal it for Valpo. So BYU fans already coming in here with a negative predisposition against Mr. Hammack.
You see some unhappy campers there on the bench for BYU. Two of the bigs, Mika and Davis, on the bench with two fouls, and it's fortunate that Emery's shooting hot, but they're going to have to continue that against a very talented Valpo team.
Not only do those two have two fouls, but as does Yoli Childs, as you see the jumper there by Jamal Yates, really the only big man that BYU has in terms of their starting rotation and their main rotation that doesn't have any fouls right now.
And he had a breakout game last game against St. Louis. He was able to knock down some shots. They expected big things from him 2.5 years ago, and they were excited to see him have a good game.
Number 15, Peyton Dastrup, the freshman, has to come in and pick up some minutes for BYU with those three big guys on the bench. He now has two rebounds. This one on the offensive glass and a putback.
And see, he's got the size, and this is what they figured that he could do. They didn't think he was going to get the playing time this year because it's really just the numbers, but it's good to have that size and depth for a basketball team.
Turnover on Max Joseph. Carried the basketball.
Well, here you see Peyton just doing a good job of creating space down on the block and goes up strong, puts it in. And for a guy that hadn't gotten a lot of time, to see that first bucket go through is going to be big for that confidence of the young fellow.
Coach Dave Rose is three big forwards on the bench with two fouls, yet Peyton Dastrup and Jamal Yates both come in and don't miss a beat. rebound. Javon Walker climbing the ladder after the TJ Hawes miss. Jabril Adekoya off the bench and making the most of it.
And that's what Jabril was able to do against Bama. Take them off the bounce, attack the slower fit of bigs, and give them that faded area to score.
Foul up top. It'll go against Valpo. Alexis Williams, the junior out of Chicago, called for the personal. It's 27-18, as you see Matt Loddick, the head coach, in his first year for Valpo. And he is the first non-Drew to be the head coach at Valpo since 1988, taking over for Bryce Drew at the end of last season, as Bryce Drew moving on to Vanderbilt. And Coach Loddick hoping that this Valparaiso team can do something that the Crusaders haven't done since 1998, and that's win an NCAA tournament.
And that's easier said than done. That a lot of schools have found out. But that has to be your goal from the onset of the season, to fight towards as a team.
Alexis Williams, the mid-range jumper. Valparaiso, in that span since 1998, has been to the NCAA tournament five times. Just has not been able to pick up the victory. So trying to grind one out here against BYU. That turnover might help. Savon Walker! And he is hit hard by the closing Elijah Bryant. He'll go to the line.
Now, when I was sitting by some NBA scouts watching on Monday, and they told me to keep an eye on Savon Walker, because they said if he gets it on the break, he will dunk on you. He's very explosive, very active defensively, and that's what he adds to this team. A guy that gets in the passing lane and creates excitement and adds to the team through his defensive prowess.
We mentioned the Lone Peak three for BYU, Emery Hawes and Mika, but let's not forget about Savon Walker and Max Joseph, who played a year of prep college ball together in Montreal, where they are both from. So they come in with a little bit of chemistry as well in the backcourt.
You're absolutely right. And, you know, when you're on a team far away from home and you can have a guy like that that you can sit and talk to, that helps you, especially once you get through the long haul for the season.
No look. Hawes, a beautiful pass, but Dastrup can't finish. Long three on the way from Walker. And he got his own rebound as it trickled out to him at the top of the key. Alexis Williams has the hot hand for the Crusaders.
You know, Eric, I thought that first shot was a little bit quick, playing into the hands of BYU, but you saw Valpo move the ball around, go side to side, and get the shot that they want. That's Valpo basketball. They take their time, they settle into their offense, and they get good looks. That's how they're going to get back into this game.
Valpo on a 7-0 run has cut the BYU lead down to 4. Hawes taking it himself.
And see, that's one of the things that Valpo lost from last year. They had Fernandez, who led the nation in blocks per game at 3.3. A little bit of a hole on the inside, and BYU smart to keep attacking that rim.
Ball movement. Hammock up top. Rips out as LJ Rose running it up to Hawes. Inside eight. Foul on the floor. Valparaiso coming to life here. Consistency in their lineup hasn't been there.
It really hasn't, but fortunately for BYU, they're the team that has the depth in the front line. If this were to happen to Valparaiso, all they have on the bench are freshmen with little to none experience. So fortunately for them, they have that scoring punch in the background.
Eric Rothman, Stephen Howard here with you courtside at the MGM Grand Garden Arena. The finals of a four-team tournament, as Valparaiso took down Alabama on Monday to advance, and BYU took down St. Louis by a 30-point margin Monday night. This is a rematch of the NIT semifinals from a season ago, with Valparaiso winning that game by 2 to advance to the tournament finals. And Alec Peters, Stephen, we know he's dealing with the flu. He just hasn't looked himself tonight.
Well, really, he hadn't looked that bad. I think the Cougars have done a great job of getting to them. They want to make him put the ball on the bounce, and that's what he's had to do. They don't want him to shoot the ball, because that's where he really is exceptional. But Val Frazier has to do a better job of getting him the ball, because he is the guy that has to go for them.
Emery driving, leaning, and a rebound by Peters. Peters only with 5 points so far. Here with just over 6 minutes to go in the first half, he averages 25 points per game.
Peters are so efficient offensively. He doesn't need much to get a shot off, but you see the double team coming before he even got the ball. BYU's not going to let him go off.
Adekoya traps baseline. Emery the steal. Emery leapfrogging over Max Joseph for the lay-in.
Nick Emery saw that pass 3 seconds before Adekoya knew he was going to make it, and just great job anticipating in the lane and just perfectly intercepted that pass.
Emery leads all scorers with 11 points. He also has 2 steals. Peters missing the three. And we mentioned Emery's older brother, Jackson, holds the BYU record for steals in a career.
That was a little bit of a heat check with that last steal that he got. And that's what Nick Emery's going to do. Sometimes he's going to take those ill-advised shots, but you got to live with those.
And a three ball by Tavon Walker in the near corner.
And that's the first three by Tavon Walker this year. So good time for him to make some noise from distance.
He's trying to redeem himself as well after he missed the semifinals of the Horizon League tournament last season when Valparaiso lost to Green Bay and when their NCAA tournament hopes were dashed. He was injured in that game and couldn't play, so hoping to redeem himself this season as Alec Peters, the lay-in, he's got 7. The freshman, Dastrup.
And that's one of the things that Dastrup can do. He can face you up. He can knock down that 15-footer. Good job by L.J. Rose taking the defense in transition and just setting the table for his players and getting some confidence for that young freshman.
There's Walker again. This time off the heel, and Hawes trying to save it, and he goes sliding down the tunnel.
Come back.
And he went in head first, and luckily nothing but space out there and didn't run into any tables or chairs or anything like that. But Stephen, BYU has held their own, even though their lead has shrunk. They've held their own with those three big men on the bench.
Oh wow, looks like they might have got away with a little contact on Adekoya in the block.
Hawes going right by Peters with the Euro step.
And Eric, that's what makes BYU dangerous. They're going to push it in transition. They shoot the ball 12.7 seconds every possession offensively. That's second in the nation. And they want to push you in transition. And sometimes they're going to take some bad shots, but they want to wear you down for that 40-minute game.
Hawes now with 10 points as Max Joseph off the mark.
And see, that's just not a shot that Valpo wants to take. Ball did not move. One pass and a shot.
Offensive rebound by 8. Peters had the steal, just couldn't corral it, and it will stay with BYU.
And here we go, BYU defense. And especially when they get everybody back and playing for a little bit more. Because even though they're playing well right now, they still have guys that have not played a lot together. And then they have Corbin Kafusi, who's playing football. And he gets back. That's another big that they're going to have. So a very talented team.
2-on-1 break as Peters, the up and under.
And again, being judicious in transition, you see Valpo, when they don't have it, they pull it back. But they've stayed in this game. But I do think this tempo is favoring BYU up around that 90-point game that they're very comfortable in.
Floater by L.J. Rose isn't there. It's the MGM Grand Main Event Championship round. It's a foul underneath as Alec Peters drives baseline. And not only, Stephen, are these two teams competing for a victory here that would do them well come March, but they're also competing for a nice championship belt as the trophy that they get to take home. Some of the boxers here at the MGM Grand over the years have taken home similar attire.
Hey, you do not want to leave Vegas with just some parting gifts. You want to leave with a nice belt. And I mean, this is a good tournament with some good resume wins to have if you can come out with that belt after this is over. Quality field, Alabama, teams that I believe throughout this season is going to help you when you have victories against them.
These two teams also playing some tough out-of-conference schedules as well outside of this tournament. As BYU has to go up against USC, Colorado, and Illinois in the coming weeks. And Valparaiso has to go up against Rhode Island and Kentucky, and they've already played Oregon. Each of these teams testing their moxie early on this season, trying to pack their resumes for March.
see Davis is back in. It's going to be interesting to see. If I'm Valpo, I'm going right at him, trying to get him with that third foul.
Davis, Mika, and Childs, both with two fouls. Davis the only one coming back in as L.J. Rose whips out the three.
Peters has been hot the last couple of possessions. This is where they need to get him back with the basketball in his hands.
Braden Shaw, the sophomore forward, the rebound, and they go up to Davin Gwynn, the junior. He's given BYU some great minutes off the bench in the early season.
He really has in running out in transition, but you see in this last possession the danger you get when you try to run against BYU, because then you don't get back in transition, and that's when BYU makes you pay.
Hamming, double-teamed in the paint. Good ball movement by Valpo. Adekoya with the three.
You know, Adekoya could knock down threes, and he showed the ability to do that last year. And he's a guy that you got to close out on when he's back along that three-point line.
BYU 12-point lead is now five as Kyle Davis gets inside.
And that's his game. Puts it on the bounce, he attacks you, left hook, right hook, can go over either shoulder. He's able to shoot over the defense with his length.
BYU has just seemed to have every answer when Valpo does something like that.
Great seal by Jabril. Really made that play by sealing Davis. Davis was not able to affect that play. And that's smart basketball by Valpo.
Shaders back within three. They have not led in this game. There's a foul away from the basket.
Max Joseph.
Go against Max Joseph.
First personal.
I talk about L.J. Rose and what he brings to this team. You see him always head on a swivel. He doesn't even dribble the ball once. Immediately knows his guys are running, looks up, sees them, doesn't waste a bounce, gets it to his guys, easy transition bucket. That's what L.J. Rose brings to this team, and that's why he was very coveted as a fifth-year player. A lot of teams wanted him. Came down to trust in the relationship his dad had with his former teammate, Coach Rose, a 30-year friendship that Lyndon Rose and Coach Rose had together.
Emery hits the free throws, extends BYU's lead 44-39. Nearing the minute mark here in the first half.
BYU in a 1-3-1.
Switching up the defensive looks, the Cougars. Good strip by Emery. Emery short on the three. Offensive rebound, Gastrup. But they're going to say a foul on the floor is against Gastrup for going over the back.
See, this is a good shot. When you're a good shooter and you're in transition, you take that. Gastrup goes up, and I don't know, that's a tough one right there, because it didn't look like that he had much body. But those are those 50-50 calls that sometimes aren't going to go your way.
Both teams in the bonus, so Alpo will go to the line, and Coach Dave Rose is red in the face, to say the least. It's BYU and their fans not happy with that foul call. I don't blame them.
Yeah, you get that. And this year they have the verticality, and the offensive or defensive player should be able to go up and get a ball like that. Get a little explanation from the official.
Jerry Pollard, Kip Kissinger, and Larry Spalding, your three referees tonight, is Lexus Williams, the junior, hitting the free throws. Back down to a three-point lead. This is as close as BYU has let Valparaiso get. So we are now under a minute to go in the half. Emery fading to his left. Tough shot. Gastro couldn't finish the tip follow.
So you really see the experience by Valparaiso. They did not get tight when they were down, and they just played their game and inched back into this ball game.
Tie ball game. Lexus Williams, the corner three, ties it up with 20 seconds to go in the half.
Lexus with two threes in this game. Really, that's not his game. He's a defensive guy, but your team guys step up for Valpo and playing big in this first half.
Huge momentum swing for the Crusaders. L.J. Rose misses. A whistle on the floor will go against Valpo as time expires. And L.J. Rose is going to go to the free throw line. Not L.J. Rose, as the foul was on the rebound, not the shot.
Yeah, and 0.6 seconds, not enough time to come down and take a shot, but plenty of time to take a free throw.
Braden Shaw, the sophomore, seldomly getting minutes for BYU so far through the first four games, getting a chance to play with some of their big guys in foul trouble. Gives BYU a two-point lead. Peters fading away. Bank shot, no good. But the Valparaiso Crusaders come storming back at the end of the first half to pull within two. We have a ball game this past season with Valparaiso coming out winner 72-70. A last-minute three-pointer and then a big block by Shane Hammock for Valparaiso to seal it.
Now, conversely, if I'm Valpo, Adekoya, and Peters, I'm going at both Davis and Mika trying to get them that third quick foul.
Mika comes right back off the bench and gets a steal for BYU.
And that's been a problem in that first half. They had 10 turnovers. You can't beat a good team turning the ball over like that.
Peters with the handle now for Valpo. He's leading the Crusaders with 11 points. Peters with 15 on the shot clock in the free throw circle. A couple bounces on the rim and a loose ball foul on the rebound will go against Tavon Walker.
You know, that step back shot that Alec Peters just took, that's a shot he can take and make, but because of the situation with BYU, with the foul trouble that they have, I would want him the first 5-6 minutes attack the rim each and every time, try to get that third foul.
Tavon Walker now with three personal fouls.
See Valpo in that 2-3, 2-3 zone.
Now a foul off the ball on the offensive end for BYU. Eric Mika.
Oh, wow. And that's that you. And setting the screen, moving on that screen. Officials they're taught to call that.
Eric Mika playing as a freshman in the 2013-2014 season for BYU and going on his Mormon mission for 2 years, and this is just his fifth game back. And he's been dealing with some foul issues now with three personal fouls and another foul. This is our third foul in the opening minute of the second half as we take a look at the Mika illegal screen.
Yeah, you can't do that. He moves into Adekoya, and that's an easy call. And I'd be shocked if Coach Rose leaves Mika into this game just because of the way that he's getting these fouls and the way the officials are calling it. You don't want him getting that fourth.
Nick Emery picked up his second personal foul. That's what the last whistle was for. Peters, mid-range, spins out.
See, Peters has to have that recognition. You have Emery on you. You got to take him down.
Oh, alley-oop! Pause to Mika!
Very athletic play. Hobbs just threw it up for Mika, and he went up and got it.
Alexis Williams swatted by Kyle Davis, and here comes Hobbs. Mika calling for it inside, bodying, and a foul on the floor will go against Adekoya.
Look at this in transition. TJ Hobbs gets it, pushes it, sees Mika in front of the defense, and just throws it up. That was a perfectly executed play in transition and something that a team that likes to run like BYU is going to get.
More foul issues this time for Valparaiso. Adekoya with three. Coast-to-coast non-contested lay-in for Shane Hammock.
But it was a great play by Hammock. You saw at the end, he saw Mika was right next to him, tried to jump into him, and Mika knew what he was going to do and just stopped because he can not afford to get that fourth foul.
Emery, baseline drive, lost it out of bounds. Nobody else touched it. Valparaiso basketball.
Coach Rose showing a lot of trust in Mika. You can see Emery just loses the ball, but really Peters got a little hand in it, and he's done that quite a bit throughout the day. Real active hands defensively.
Emery's first turnover of the game. He does have 13 points.
See BYU in a zone now, and that's partially to protect Mika with his foul trouble.
So Mika down there in the center of that 2-3 zone with three fouls, and then on the left side, the near side to us, is Kyle Davis, who's on the floor with two fouls.
And this is the play they worked on in shoot around. They want to post up Alec at the free throw line or down on the block, get him the ball there and let him take advantage.
Five on the shot clock, Adekoya spinning, pirouetting, nowhere to go. Hammock out to Peters, one, lost it going up, but he got bailed out because TJ Hawes committed the foul.
Again, that's just a veteran guy. You're looking at Alec Peters, a guy that graduated in 3 years, so he just takes his time. That's poise in the pocket. Goes up, and T.J. Hawes, ill-advised foul with really no time on the clock.
Alec Peters, you mentioned he graduated last year. He's a senior. He could have, as a graduate, gone to a bigger program if he wanted to, and he was coveted by a lot of those bigger programs, those power conference programs. But Matt Loddick, in his first year coming in, convincing Alec Peters to stay with the Crusaders, see out his fourth year in the gold uniform. And boy, if the Crusaders go anywhere this year, it's going to be because Alec Peters stuck around.
Yeah, and there's probably only about five teams that wouldn't have sold the house in the kitchen sink to get Alec Peters on his team. And I don't know if it took a lot of convincing, because this is a high-character guy, a loyal guy, and he wanted to see this through. And, you know, at the end of his career, he's going to be the all-time leading scorer and rebounder for Valpo. And, you know, it's a credit to what he's trying to accomplish with this team.
His free throws give Valpo their first lead of the game, but it didn't last very long. Eric Miko with those three fouls. Nice fadeaway jumper.
You know, he's shown the ability of going over either shoulder, and he likes to use the glass. And he's, you know, very high skill set.
Hamming underneath, can't finish with the left. Blocked by Davis on the second effort by Peters. Miko controlling, but can't finish. Kick out Walker for three, and Emery climbing the ladder for the rebound. Up and down we go. Emery keeping the pace. And a whistle and a foul against Eric Miko, his fourth.
And again, Coach Rose showed trust, but Miko has to know that he can't do that. And you're going to see Emery go up, and this is really an ill-advised shot. He had numbers, and Miko just went over the back of Peters. Not smart, and he knew immediately that he had just blown it.
There are a couple have over the back violations for this BYU team in this game that have made these fans very upset. In the first half, Peyton Dastrup got called for one on the offensive glass, and this time Eric Miko was trailing the play and picks up his fourth.
And again, that's that youth and immaturity, and he's telling the official, "You're killing me," but really, he was killing himself just with plays that weren't smart down the stretch.
Got to be protective with those fouls. Walker for three, giving Valpo the lead.
You're seeing some guards for Valpo step up and make shots that they don't normally make or take.
Hawes frustrated. The offensive foul, and somebody needs to restrain Lexus Williams from Valpo, because he almost picked up a technical for
you. That's not acceptable. But two, when you blatantly throw an elbow to an opposing player, could injure that player. And then secondly, to push a ball into the opposing player's face, again, that's not part of basketball either.
So free throw by Alec Peters, and the ball will go back to Valparaiso. So T.J. Hawes picks up the technical, heading to the bench. And we're seeing the Cougars now, Steven, starting to fray a little bit as Valpo has come storming back to take a four-point lead.
And you got to remember, T.J. Hawes is a freshman. This is his first battle in the heat of the moment for a collegiate type of competition. So really, his emotions just got the best of him.
Good block by Child Davis on the ground. And a timeout taken as Kyle Davis got the turnover, and a smart play to not get up off of his knees. Instead, call the timeout.
Yeah, smart play by Alec Peters. By
trailing for the first 23 minutes of this ball game, as T.J. Hawes, you see on the bench after a technical foul for throwing the ball in Lexus Williams' face after he didn't like the double team that he was getting on the near side. So Hawes picked up the personal and the technical, and Peters picks up the steal out of the timeout, up to Kevin, and the Valparaiso lead grows.
And again, Eric, I talked about this in the first half, the experience of Valparaiso. When they were down double-digit points, they did not get too down. They crept back into this game, and when they got back into it, you saw the tempers and the emotions of BYU, the less experienced team, start to flare, and Valpo really clear momentum in this game.
7-0 run currently for Valpo, 12-2 run over the last 3 minutes.
And this is where you worry that sometimes Dick Emery tries to do too much.
Gwynn for three. Knocks it down.
Gwynn came into this game 50% from the three-point line, doing a good job coming in off the bench. Very difficult to do, knocking down shots.
Brings the Cougars within three, and tough to do even more so with that face mask on after he broke his nose in the preseason. Alec Peters now has 18 points and 9 rebounds.
That's a play that BYU knew they were going to take, that high pick and roll. And when you hard hedge, which BYU is doing it, particularly off a guy like Alec Peters, makes it very difficult to defend.
Offensive rebound by Gwynn. Emery thought about it. Back to Gwynn. Gwynn back-to-back threes, and he ties it up.
And that's his ball movement.
Excuse me, down by two. BYU down by two with that three.
That's just great ball movement by Brigham Young. You saw Nick Emery with the ball, bringing the defense to him, knowing that Gwynn's got the nice rhythm. And just throwing it to him and knocking it down. See, great anticipation to him because he knows that they're keyed on him, and then getting it to a wide open jump shooter. When you're wide open like that, it's very easy to knock down shots. Great ball movement by BYU.
Gwynn the rebound. And we saw during the break, Coach Dave Rose for BYU having a nice long conversation with the officials as Emery caught in the air. And Rose was concerned because his team had been called for 7 fouls, whereas Valparaiso had only been called for 2 in this first half. And what do you know, out of the timeout, a foul on the Crusaders.
And you're seeing the defense by Valpo on Nick Emery. They're hawking him everywhere he goes. This is just trying to make him, give him a little bit of space.
Davis backing inside. Good defense by Peters, but a better move by Davis.
You get a guy like Davis with his height and length, with his ability to score and elevate over the defense. Alec Peters allowed him to get too low offensively.
Alexis Williams left alone. Bryant flying in for the rebound.
Foul on the rebound.
And the foul is going to go against BYU.
You're just going to see, going for the rebound, Elijah Bryant over the top.
The foul was on BYU.
Yeah, and that was really a foul that could have gone either way, but Elijah Bryant, they called it on him, going over the top.
So Bryant flying in, using his body wildly. And as I mentioned, Dave Rose was arguing the team fouls, which is now up to 8 for BYU. So a lot of time left with Valpo in the bonus.
Yeah, and Valpo is a team that you do not want to get in the bonus, shooting 81% from the free throw line. So they're going to win that free throw battle.
Valpo a 2-point lead. Bryant lost it off of his shoe. Ball loose. Bryant got it back. And a foul going up. Elijah Bryant stuck with the play even after he lost it.
You know, they have high hopes and high promise for Bryant, but you're going to see him when he gets the ball, he just immediately tries to score, and he needs to get a little bit more composure because he's trying to will himself to the basket, and the game is not slowed down for him yet. It's going to happen. It's going to come, but he's trying to get it all in one play, making some ill-advised passes, ill-advised shots. Just needs to slow his game down a little bit.
Elijah Bryant is a transfer from Elon University and was the Colonial Athletic Conference Rookie of the Year as a freshman, where he averaged 14 points, 4 rebounds, and 3 assists. So a big transfer pickup for Coach Dave Rose and the Cougars. And Bryant ties things up with those 2 free throws, and Alec Peters picked up his 2nd foul on the play.
Going to try to post up Peters with the reverse screen. And BYU did a good job of snuffing that out.
Hammock splitting the defense up with the left hand.
Look, this is what BYU knew that Valpo wanted to do. They get the ball and they want to attack the paint. They want to get it to the rim. The second half, Valpo's did a good job of really putting their imprint on this game by getting to the rim.
Davis calling for it off the pick and roll. Tough shot off the heel.
And that's not really Davis's game. He's a guy that really set the play for him. He's not going to create a bucket on his own.
Hammock, the one-hand jam.
panic is taking over in this nice little three-possession stretch for Valpo.
As Hammack now with 14 points. What a strong take by Shane Hammack.
Got to remember, he's a lefty. So he's going to that strong hand. Nice crossover to the right, but then he's going up and over. Great job just going to his strong suit and posterizing Yoli Childs for BYU.
Elme Soroya picks up the foul for Valparaiso on the other end. Elijah Bryant back to the free throw line. And on the previous play as well, it should be noted that Alec Peters with that rebound, now a double-double, 18 and 10. Big night, even with those flu-like symptoms for Alec Peters. But Elijah Bryant back to the free throw line where he makes the pair, and it's 64-62.
And that's what Alec Peters does. You look up at the end of the game, and you're like, oh, he had a bad game, and he's going to end up with 24, 26 points in a double-double.
Soroya not ready for the pass. It was a good look by Joseph. Turnover on Valparaiso. But Shane, a monster dunk to give Valpo the lead, 64-62, under 12 minutes to play in the second half. It's BYU basketball here on Feast Week. And the reserves for BYU trying to keep the Cougars in it with a lot of their starters on the bench with foul trouble. As a foul underneath on Tavon Walker will send Elijah Bryant back to the free throw line where he is already a perfect 4-for-4.
And you're just seeing Elijah Bryant playing smart basketball. He's got the height advantage over Tavon Walker. He's only 6'1". Just backs him down, waits till he gets that advantage and feels that bump and goes up over.
Tavon Walker, third leading scorer tonight for Valparaiso, picks up his fourth foul, so he goes to the bench. Lexus Williams is back in. So now a couple guys with four fouls, one for Valpo, one for BYU. Eric Mika, the sophomore forward, is on the bench for the Cougars.
You know, when you look at Valpo and how they got back in the game, they excelled in all the toughness stats. They're plus 8 points in the paint, plus 6 second chance points, and plus 9 on points off turnover. So they just played smart basketball.
Peters the straightaway three.
And that's a lapse in defense that you can't have against a guy that's more likely than not going to be suiting up for an NBA team next year.
21 points now for Peters, and a traveling violation on the inside by Kyle Davis. Turnover on BYU, their 10th as a team.
And I would think that Coach Rose is going to sit on Mika on the bench to at least around the 8-7 minute mark, particularly the way that these officials is calling this game pretty tight.
TJ Hawes and Nick Emery also both on the bench for Coach Rose with three fouls.
BYU back in that zone.
Williams bumped. LJ Rose, I believe, will be picking up the personal foul.
Now, Eric, the difficult thing about playing Valpo in a zone is they're very adept at getting to the rim, hitting the gaps. And so this is a team that already does that, and that's what a zone gives up. And you're seeing Valpo showing the ability to do this every time the BYU goes into that zone.
And is it part of that not only the zone, but also Peter's ability to spread the floor down low and open up those lanes?
Yeah, you have to respect him. So wherever he is, he's in that no-fly zone where you don't even want him to have any type of room to get a shot off. But, you know, Coach Rose talked about it, that Valpo does a lot of things that they don't see a lot of. They shoot late in the shot clock, they attack the gaps, they drive to the rim. And you're seeing that in this second half, that BYU is kind of flushing a little bit defensively.
Be ready for that battle in Atlantis tomorrow from the Bahamas. A couple top 25 teams to start your day. Then Louisville, Wichita State in the afternoon as Bryant tied up in a held ball. Good job by Valpo on the interior.
Again, Eric, I told you a couple minutes ago that every time Elijah Bryant gets the basketball, he immediately tries to attack. He doesn't survey the defense, and he just goes into crowded spaces a lot of times.
Possession arrow in favor of the Cougars. 10 on the shot clock now for Yoli Childs with the roll.
Yoli Childs.
BYU is an inside-out team. They're going to have to play to their strengths down the stretch to try to get back into this game.
BYU within four. Adekoye calling for it in the corner.
I like the patience by Valpo going side to side.
Nine on the shot clock. Hammack up top to Joseph. Five to shoot at the free throw line. And a rebound underneath by Elijah Bryant, who has come in and played some really important minutes, and gets the feed in front to Eric Mika, who's back in with those four fouls and missed the gimme.
That's just the rust of sitting 10 minutes on the bench.
Lexus Williams, his three rattles out.
That was a heat check for Lexus, who's gone 2 for 3 from distance in this game.
Mika double team and clocked in the face by Alec Peters, who picks up his third personal.
Now you're noticing Valpo, every time a big gets the ball on the block, immediately they send another big. You're gonna see Alec Peters go straight for that double team, go up, and a little bit of foul on the arm. But the bigs of BYU have not shown the ability much of throwing out of that double team, which is why Valpo has stayed with that double team on the block.
Dinka hits the front end, and his foul trouble has really slowed down his production tonight. He came in averaging 21 points and 11 rebounds, and tonight just 5 points and one rebound in limited action, just 10 minutes of play with those fouls, and he's hoping that he can redeem himself here with the Cougars down by 2 and the BYU fans on their feet.
One of the benefits of BYU is they travel real well, and they have fans all across the country. It doesn't even matter if it's not geographically close. We're going to have some good fans out to support him.
Tough shot for Peters. Loose ball. Joseph fighting for it. The smallest guy in the scrum. And a block out of bounds by Yoli Childs. It's a late game back east. Probably not a lot of East Coasters staying up for this game. But it's the biggest party night of the year. The night before Thanksgiving. I know the sports bars back east are packed watching this game right now.
You're absolutely right. This is the best time of the year. College basketball is in full swing.
Hammock, step back three. Rebounded by Childs. Nobody there. The steal. And the deal for Shane Hammock after the errant pass by Emery.
Hammock has played really big for this team in the second half. He had some spurts in the first half, but down the stretch, he showed some experience.
Loose ball picked up by Adekoye.
And you see Valpo, they might have had numbers on that possession, but they know their strength is half-court offense. They're slowing it down, getting the shot that they want in this possession.
Shane Hammock, after that dunk a moment ago, has 16 points on 7 of 12 shooting.
BYU back in that 1-3-1 defense.
Peters goes up underneath. A foul on BYU called against Yoli Childs.
And here you've seen Hammock. He missed a shot, but he did not give up. Look, a really casual pass by BYU, and Hammock just closer, wanted it more, attacked it, and got that loose ball for an easy deuce in transition.
So now Peters, the free throw line, BYU has committed over 10 team fouls. So Valpo in the double bonus. On the other end, BYU is in the single bonus as TJ Hawes is back into the game because Nick Emery picked up his fourth foul.
Rare miss by Alec Peters. Only missed 2 free throws thus far in this season. Before that miss,
Coach Matt Loddick looking for his first signature win as head coach of the Valparaiso Crusaders. Bryant for 3. And a whistle, I believe Valpo. It's off the ball. Go against Valpo.
Again, Bryant took that shot. They iced the pick and roll and kind of went one-on-one. BYU just fortunate they got that foul off the ball.
Childs to the line in the bonus. Hits the front end. The foul was on Max Joseph. BYU led for 23 of the game's first 24 minutes. And since then, Valparaiso has come back with a vengeance. And they hold a 72-68 lead here, nearing the 8-minute mark of the second half.
BYU standing in that 1-3-1. Got to pay attention to Alec Peters on that baseline, because 1-3-1 gives up that baseline shot.
Hammock calling for it at the free throw line. Good ball movement. Lexus Williams rebounded by BYU. That's a bad pass. Oh, they got lucky. BYU got lucky. Childs can't finish. Mika, the offensive rebound, and he'll go to the line.
So BYU is staying to their core. They're a transition team. They really...
dynamic there with 16 points. He averages 15, so right around his average. The transfer from LSU, spent a couple seasons with the Tigers, as Eric Mika at the free throw line, and he's done pretty well for the past 2.5 minutes since he came back on the floor with those four fouls.
Yeah, he's played composed. He hasn't really tried to go after too many offensive rebounds. And see, that was his strength coming into this game, his ability to get offensive rebounds. And he's had to kind of take a little step back, because when you're that aggressive, you can get those kind of loose ball fouls at times.
Foul trouble been an issue tonight for Mika. Just 12 minutes of action with 8 points. And the game clock malfunction will get things going again, as Mika, again, returning from his two-year Mormon mission after playing as a freshman in 2013 and 14. And making a statement with his BYU Cougars here at the MGM Grand main event, and it's a turnover on Valpo. Numbers for the Cougars. Hawes, head fake, two steps into the lane, and a finish for TJ Hawes.
Patient basketball right there by BYU. Elijah Bryant took his time. Down Hawes on the wing, and that was a great offensive play by BYU.
5-0 run ties things up for the Cougars. Not for long, as wow. Max Joseph the three.
The perimeter players for Valpo, guys that don't normally knock down shots, have come up big for Valparaiso. And again, Elijah Bryant, an ill-advised shot. He just made a good play, and he came down the next possession. Didn't rush the shot. You're going to have that shot all the way through the shot clock.
Oh, nice pass.
Good dish inside by Joseph, trying to find Peters. But knocked out of bounds. Will stay with Valparaiso.
And you're seeing Valpo, the ability, whenever they want, to attack the gaps, get into the paint, and either take it all the way to the rim or give it nice assist to their teammate.
Peters falling in the lane and a foul. If this goes against Eric Mika, that's a problem. And it is. It's on Mika, his fifth.
And really, that's just a smart play by Peters. He realizes that when he goes up and initiates contact, they're going to have to make a call. And then Mika, just unfortunate, in the wrong place. But you're seeing here, Peters does a great job getting into the painted area, and clearly it's on Yoeli Childs. But Alec Peters, that veteran leadership, going into the painted area and creating that contact, knowing that they need a bucket.
So the referees do the right thing. They change the foul call, not on Eric Mika, who was originally whistled. It's on Yoeli Childs. So still, Alec Peters is at the free throw line, extending Valpo's lead. But at least for the moment, Eric Mika gets to stay on the floor with those four fouls. Childs now has to take a seat. Kyle Davis is back in as Peters hits them both. 5-0 run now for Valpo, separating after the tie at 72.
And this is where they try to go to Mika down on the block after that UCLA cut.
Davis left alone, good spin as he caught the ball, and a foul underneath on Valparaiso.
And that's the strength of BYU, inside out. You're gonna see a little bit of a dangerous pass by Elijah. But I didn't see that foul right there by Shane Hammock. It looked like he went up and had that verticality. But when you attack the rim with your big, you're going to get those type of calls when you establish that inside game.
Kyle Davis, another one of those big men for BYU that didn't see a ton of action in that first half because he picked up two early fouls, but making his mark here in the second half with 9 points. Coach Rose calming down at least for the moment. This is Cougars back within three.
BYU has stayed in that 1-3-1 zone. I'd like for them to try to find Alec on a reversal because that baseline is open.
Kick ball by Hawes. And let's not forget that Hawes lost his temper there earlier in the first half and picked up a technical foul after he was called for a personal offensive foul. And he decided to take the ball and very unfriendly throw it in the face of Lexus Williams. Got called for the technical. Hawes is back out on the floor. He's got three fouls.
And you see how far BYU extends that 1-3-1, getting really high up near half court line.
Swing pass. Adekoya for three.
And again, Eric, heard me say it, that baseline is open when they play 1-3-1. Big shot by Adekoya. Great ball movement.
Bryant, like a running back into the lane. and a foul on Bryant, offensive charge.
And that's what Bryant has been doing throughout this whole game. He gets the basketball. We're looking at this last play, though. Great ball movement. Gets it up top. Quick swing to Adekoye on the baseline, and he knocks it down. But on the other side, Bryant, look, you got the defense 5 seconds to set up in legal guarding position. You got to know they're going to do that. He's shown this whole game that really been too aggressive attacking the rim. You got to be patient, and you got to pull up for that short jump shot or pull it out.
Stats very even in terms of three-point shooting. Adekoye, back-to-back great plays, the three-pointer, and then drew the charge.
Foul called outside.
And a foul off the ball. Hand check call on
second personal.
Valparaiso, or excuse me, on BYU. LJ Rose picks up the personal. And because each team is in the double bonus, that sends Shane Hammack to the free throw line.
Shane Hammack at the line shoots two.
It's a rematch of the NIT semifinals from last season. Valparaiso came away with a two-point victory. And if that game was any indication of how this one was going to go, it's pretty spot on.
Yeah, in that game, BYU controlled the tempo in the first half, and Valpo controlled it in the second half, and really, that's what's happened in this game.
Hammack now up to 18 points.
Really, the foul trouble for Nick Emery has really hurt BYU, because they had 5 three-pointers in the first half, and they haven't been able to get loose really from the three-point line in the second half.
Mika is fouled, and even with those 4 fouls, Steven, he has been aggressive attacking the basket on the offensive end.
Here you see them posting up Mika, and great job of feeling the body on his side and knowing what direction he should go and going to the baseline where there is no defensive help. He's just going up strong.
Jabril Adekoye now with 4 personal fouls. Mika to the free throw line. Mika has hit now 7 of 8 free throws.
And Eric, one of the more difficult things to do as a player when you have foul trouble is to stay aggressive and to play your game. And for the most part, Eric Meek has been able to do that in the second half.
Nearing the 5-minute mark here in the second half. Eric Rothman, Stephen Howard with you. Valpo up by 6. Looking to take home the championship belt here at the MGM Grand main event. Peters, ball handling, and a charge on Peters as Davin Gwynn has been a spark off the bench in the first half. He hit 2 threes, and in the second half, coming in and taking the charge.
Yeah, great defensive play. You're going to see that arm extended by Alec Peters, and then Gwynn sold it just a little bit because he really didn't need to, because it was a clear offensive charge by Alec Peters.
And now 4 fouls on Alec Peters. Things just got that much more interesting.
Yeah, and Alec Peters is a guy that is irreplaceable for Valpo. You can lose some guys. BYU can lose their bigs, but Alec Peters is a guy that Valpo is would really struggle to win without.
Oh, he's left alone in the corner. Quick release for the 3. He got rid of that thing in about a 1/10 of a second.
You talk about letting it fly. T.J. Haas knew the second he got it that he was going to let it go, and that was spot on the money.
Peters can't answer. And BYU basketball out of bounds.
You know, even watching tape, one thing that I love about Alec Peters is how efficient that he is. He doesn't really take a lot of bad shots, but that's the first rush shot that I've seen Alec Peters take.
5-0 run for the Cougars. Taking his time.
Drop one to 2-3 zone.
Mika on the high post. Rattles out. Loose ball. Mika diving for it. Knocks it to Emery. Tie ball game!
See, this is where Alec Peters needs to really get the ball and make something happen.
Nearly does. Halfway in before it pops out. Joseph, offensive rebound. No whistle, and Davis secures it.
If BYU is able to score on this possession, the roof might go off of this arena with this very partisan crowd for the Cougars.
Emery double team, forces it up. Adekoya gets it.
That was a little bit of a rush shot by Nick Emery. Went into traffic. Should have pulled that out.
Manning, the southpaw, fouled, and he'll go to the line. And Shane Hammond, the big senior forward from the Netherlands, has been a big reason why this team is where it is right now.
Well, he really has, and he's really done a good job in this second half of taking control and coming up with huge shots down the stretch with 18 points, and he's been very efficient, but just doing the things that he does. Great ball handler and attacking the rim, which is his strength.
Gets the free throw on the back end, 83-82 now. BYU looking to speed up the pace. That's where they have been most successful tonight. Quinn left alone. Buckets! Okay. Davin Quinn, Steven, off the bench. A perfect 3-for-3 from long distance.
Yeah, and this is a guy that only averages 6 points a game. And here he is coming up huge for BYU down the stretch with 11 points, 4-for-4 from the field.
Cougars reclaim the lead. 10 on the shot clock now for Valpo. Hammond turning the corner with his offhand, goes up with the left and gets a friendly bounce.
And again, you know what Valpo is going to do. They're going to get the ball. They're going to attack the rim. BYU knows what they're going to do. But great teams, even when you know what they're going to do, they're still able to do it.
Kick ball. Tied up at 85. What a slugfest this has been, and aptly named the MGM Grand.
And Eric, I would think that BYU is going to try to go to the big fella, Eric Mika, down the stretch, because he's got the size advantage down on the block with Adekoya, who's only 230, and Mika, a very solid 240. They're going to need to try to ride him down the stretch.
These two heavyweights going at it, looking for that championship belt, the MGM Grand main event. Oz tiptoeing in the lane, rebounded by Adekoya.
I think if BYU would have been a little bit more patient, we'll see Meek on him.
Javon Walker, who has been quiet all game because of some foul trouble, hits the three, and on the other end, Emery will get a chance to shoot three from the free throw line.
And see, when you're a guy like Nick Emery, Valpo knows it. During the scout, like, look, this guy will shoot it whenever he wants. But first, you got Valpo. Great job by Adekoya pushing it in transition and throwing out to his wide-open jump shooters on the baseline. Tevin Walker doing a good job. But then Nick Emery, look, they know he'll pull it up at any time, and that's that shot credibility. That little foul on the wrist. Good call by the officials.
Foul on Max Joseph. Let's run over everybody who has four fouls in this game. Walker, Joseph, Adekoya, and Peters all have four fouls for Valpo. Emery and Mika both on the floor for BYU with four of their own. Two of the three for Emery. 88-87, under 2 minutes to play.
Late game execution down the stretch.
Shot clock for Peters. Faces up. Roulette's out for Alec Peters. Looked good. Just wouldn't fall. Cougars down one. Here's Mika on the inside. Good defense by Peters to get the steal.
Great job by Peters. First through the floor. Coming up with that loose ball. Peters hit some big shots down the stretch against Bama. They know he's their go-to guy.
Now Valpo draining some clock with 1 minute to play in regulation.
But those ancillary players for Valpo have come up big, so they got a lot of guys they can go to.
And a foul. Not a very smart play by Kyle Davis, as Shane Hammock was 30 feet away with 6 seconds on the shot clock. Both of these teams in the double bonus, so that's automatic free throw attempts for Hammock.
Yeah, that's not the foul that you wanted. Again, just like you mentioned, not a smart play. by Davis. You want to try to get something defensively, go for a steal, but you don't want to stop the clock and allow him to get easy buckets on the charity stripe.
Especially with six on the shot clock and nothing was developing for Valpo. Now Hammack at the line, and Hammack has become the leading scorer on the floor. Excuse me, he's one behind his teammate Peters.
This is a one possession game. They don't necessarily have to go for the three. Take the best shot available.
Emery thought about it. Mika left alone.
Again, Eric, you ride your horse that got you here. That's Eric Mika. He's the most dominating player in the block. You got to keep going to that because he's got the size advantage down low.
11-second difference between the game clock and the shot clock. Valpo hanging on to a one-point lead.
1-4 flat. You got to watch the cross screen. They sometimes post up Peters with this play or use him as a high screener with a pick and pop.
Hammack goes against the screen. Peters, three to shoot. Up with the right hand, and Peters extends Valpo's lead.
With 1 second on the shot clock, that's that veteran poise by Alec Peters.
Emery, bank shot not there. Off a foul on BYU as the rebound by Max Joseph stops the clock at 2.9 seconds. Emery had the look to tie it.
Now, Eric, I said you ride the horse to get you for BYU. Well, that's also Alec Peters for Valpo. You see him get the ball. He can create off the bounce. That would makes him so dangerous at 6'9". The ability to get up, play through the contact, up and over, and just definitely lay it in off the glass.
Big missed free throw by Max Joseph. And you see there, Coach Loddick wants to take the timeout. Stripe. Valpo up by three, looking to knock off the undefeated BYU Cougars. Joseph misses it short. Mika, the rebound and a timeout. Only 7 tenths of a second come off the clock, and it's still a three-point game.
Yeah, 3 points.
Combination of Emery and Hawes have 7 of those. Davis to inbound. BYU down by three. Final 2 seconds of the game. Davis, football pass. Mika calls a timeout. Smart play over the timeline. Advances the ball with 1.9 seconds to go.
And so now the options for Rose have just coached.
Emery and Hawes, the two you want to keep an eye on. Under 2 seconds to go. The inbound by Rose. BYU trailing by three. Rose has to get it in. Hawes tipped it. Mika fading away. Air ball. Not the play BYU wanted. And Valparaiso wins the heavyweight belt at the MGM Grand Main Event.